Even though the COVID pandemic forced most test-taking centers to close all around the world, and most universities decided to waive the GRE for their graduate school applications, many have gone back to requiring it. Chances are you're here listening to this because at least one of the schools that you're planning to apply to requires it. And the GRE is not just required for graduate programs in engineering. From humanities and arts and social and behavioral sciences to education and engineering, many master's and PhD programs require you to take the GRE. Even some business degrees will take the GRE scores as an alternative to the GMAT. So make sure to check if your MBA program would take the GRE, as it is a relatively easier exam. As of 2024, the GRE general test is composed of three sections: verbal reasoning, quantitative reasoning, and analytical writing. This playlist of videos will focus on preparing you for the quantitative reasoning section. If you're watching this years from now and the exam has changed, I'll make sure to update what needs to be updated and link the new versions of these videos in the description below. The quantitative reasoning section itself, commonly referred to as the math section, contains four types of questions: quantitative comparisons, multiple choice questions with one correct choice, multiple choice questions with one or more correct answers, and numeric entry questions. In these main 10-minute lecture videos, we'll focus on mastering the concepts and topics included in the math section, and there will be one specific 10-minute one on the quantitative comparisons to explain how it works and some of the tips you can use. As for the types of problems, the examples for each of these main lectures, linked in the description of each, will include at least one of each type of question. Finally, know that the general content of this math section is not undergraduate or graduate level math. The GRE's topics include arithmetic operations, integer rules and properties, basic algebra and plots, inequalities, basic geometry without any proofs, words to equations translation, data analysis, charts and diagrams, rates, and elementary probability and descriptive statistics concepts. These are relatively simple topics, and most of the preparation you need to perform well in this test comes down to using your time wisely and solving the problems quickly. So many of the tips you'll learn here with me will be focused on saving as much time as possible. Today we'll begin with arithmetic operations. This topic includes percentages, fractions, ratios and decimals, reciprocals, order of operations, and exponents and roots. So let's begin with percentages, fractions, ratios and decimals. Percentages are in essence just fractions. The word percentage means per every 100. Therefore, something like 20% is just 20 over 100. Usually, answer choices given in fractions are always presented in lowest terms. This means that if the numerator and the denominator can both be divided by the same number without yielding a decimal, the fraction is still not in lowest terms. For example, 20 and 100 can both be divided by 5, and therefore 20 over 100 is the same as 4 over 20. And again, since both 4 and 20 can be divided by 4, 4 over 20 can be written as 1 over 5 or 1/5. 1/5 would be the lowest terms version of the fraction 20 over 100. Within the fractions topic, it's important to know that some of the GRE problems will sporadically present them as mixed fractions. This is a whole number with a fraction next to it. It basically means that we have one or more of something plus an additional fraction. You have to be very careful and not see this as a multiplication. Even though it's not there, a plus sign exists between the whole number and the fraction. Every time the numerator is larger than the denominator, we call this an improper fraction, and improper fractions can always be presented as mixed fractions. To switch from improper to mixed, you simply divide. For example, if we have 20 over 3, we know that 6 threes fit in 18, and the additional 2 that remain to get to 20 should also be divided by 3. Therefore, 20 over 3 is 6 2/3. A calculator would agree with this by saying that 20 over 3 is 6.6 repeating. More on decimals in a second. To switch from mixed to improper, all we are really doing is using a common denominator. 6 2/3, which we just explained is 6 2/3, is also 6/1 + 2/3. The common denominator will always be the denominator of the original fraction, in this case 3. And since the whole number will always have a 1 in its denominator, we just need to multiply it by the denominator of the fraction. 6 is 18 over 3, and when added to 2 over 3, we get 20 over 3. So the summary of this process is that we multiply the whole number by the denominator, add the numerator, and keep the original denominator. For example, 4 and 2 fifths would be 5 times 4, 20, plus 2, 22, over the original denominator 5, or 22 over 5. Now, if we take a fraction, and instead of writing it as two numbers divided by a horizontal segment, we put a colon in between, we call this a ratio, and we read it as 4 to 10, or for example, the previous fraction, 22 to 5. We'll touch on when ratios are usually used in a later topic, but for now, know that you can even have a three-part ratio. For example, we can be told that the number of phones to tablets to laptops in a classroom is 5 to 2 to 4. This would be harder to state with fractions or percentages. This means that for every 2 tablets, there are 5 phones and 4 laptops. If you knew, for example, that there are 12 laptops in this classroom, and since 12 is 3 times the given ratio value, we multiply all ratio parts by 3 to find the actual number of phones and tablets, 15 and 6. Just like a fraction, if you multiply one part by a number, the other parts need to be multiplied by the same number to keep the same fraction. And finally, decimals are just what you get when you carry out the division. So like I said, if we use a calculator, even the one you're allowed to use during the exam to calculate 20 over 3, we get 6.6 repeating. This makes sense because 2 over 3 is 0.6 repeating. Now, I recommend not using the calculator at all, and instead working on your mental math as much as you can while preparing for the GRE. But if you do use it, and you get to an answer like this, but the options are fractions, percentages, or ratios, it's important to know what the different decimals correspond to. In general, I would never suggest anyone memorizing math or physics-related information, but for the purpose of this one-off exam, it's okay to do so. So here's a list of what the common fractions, percentages, and decimals look like in case we need to identify, for example, that 0.6 repeating is 2/3, or that, and this is a hard one but a common one, 0.142857 repeating is 1/7. This is all there is to percentages, fractions, ratios, and decimals. Now for reciprocals, we don't need to know much except you trade places between the numerator and the denominator. So if we have 2 over 5, its reciprocal is 5 over 2. And if we have a whole number, for example 8, since it can be written as a fraction as 8 over 1, its reciprocal is 1 over 8. And this applies to ratios, and it could also apply to percentages. And this is reciprocals. The general order of operations is obviously important. We want to remember that we do parentheses, then exponents, then multiplication and division from left to right, and then addition and subtraction from left to right. But this here refers more to how to translate percentages or fractions word problems to equations. The word of means you multiply. The word what, or the expression how much, is the variable x that you're solving for. And the word is means an equal sign. So for a simple problem like, what is 40% of 1/5 of 300, we write x equals to 40% times 1/5 times 300. In this case, we would just multiply the fractions knowing that 40% is 2/5. And similarly, in a less straightforward problem, we could be asked what percentage of 84 is 21. Here we would write x percent times 84 equals 21. And then we would solve for x. The exponents and roots topic refers mostly to exponentiation rules. Let's go over these quickly. If a to the 3 means multiplying 3 a's, and a to the 5 means multiplying 5 a's, then a to the 3 times a to the 5 is a to the 8. This means that we can add exponents when the same base is found in a multiplication. And in the same manner, if we divide a to the 5 by a to the 3, it means that we can subtract exponents when the same base is found in the division. These are known as the product and the quotient rule for exponents. Now, if a to the 5 is all to the power of 3, it would mean we have a multiplication of a to the 5 3 times. If we expand this, we end up with 15 a's. This is called the power rule. Now, what about negative exponents? Well, since those could be written as 0 minus the given number, we can use the quotient rule to say that a to the minus 4 is a to the 0 over a to the 4. And what is a to the 0? Well, we can use the quotient rule for that as well. A to the 0 can be a to the x minus x, which is a to the x over a to the x. And this is just 1, therefore a to the 0 is just 1. And with this, we know that a to the minus 4 is 1 over a to the 4. These are called the zero exponent rule and the negative exponent rule. The negative exponent rule can be expanded to say that if a is a fraction and the exponent is negative, we can just take the reciprocal of the fraction and the positive version of the exponent. And even though it's not common to see in the GRE test, it's important to know that a fraction as the exponent means you'll take the nth root where n is that number. For example, 1/2 is the square root, 1/3 is the cubic root, and any fraction that does not have a 1 in the numerator becomes the exponent inside the root. For example, 4 over 5 as the exponent would be the 5th root of the number to the 4th. Therefore, if we have an expression like this, we can write 25 as 5 squared, merge it with the 5 to the 4, cancel it with the 5 to the 6, use the quotient rule for the tens, which end up being a 10, and use the negative exponent rule on it by taking its reciprocal and evaluating the 10 to the 2. Like I mentioned in the beginning of this video, I'll have GRE type question examples for each of these subtopics linked in the description below, and I'll try to include at least one of each of the 4 types of questions I briefly explained. So make sure to check out the links found in the description of this video. You'll find the links to all the other topics of the math section of the GRE there. Thanks for watching!